Okay, this sermon is entitled The Cloak of Bartimaeus. I'd like to open up with prayer, and then with a few verses. All right, dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says. Bless the listeners, I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Proverbs 22 reads, A good name is rather to be chosen than great riches, and loving favor rather than silver and gold. The rich and poor meet together. The Lord is the maker of them all. A prudent man foreseeth the evil and hideth himself, but the simple pass on and are punished. Now, if you turn over to Mark chapter 10, we see the story of Bartimaeus. And before I get into the story, I'd like to explain that back in first century, Palestine, they had lots of beggars and lots of, derelicts, lots of destitute people, and they would wear cloaks, and of course, underneath they had tunics. And a lot of times when these people would take their cloaks and just, throw their cloak to the ground, it represented a total divestiture. It represented a total relinquishment of one's, goods, because a lot of times that's all they had was their cloak. And these people were deemed as being cursed for doing this. And as we read, we're going to see that Bartimaeus, threw his cloak down, or his garment, but this has a slightly different meaning than just being accursed or cursed because you are, throwing everything away. This has to do with faith. So let's take a look at a few verses here. Let's look at verse 45, and we'll stop with verse 52. And it reads, For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life a ransom for many. And they came to Jericho, and as he went out of Jericho with his disciples, and a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. And when he had heard, when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him that he should hold his peace. But he cried the more a great deal, Thou son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they call the blind man, saying unto him, Be of good comfort. Rise, he calleth thee. And in verse 50 it reads, And he, casting away his garment, rose and came to Jesus. Now notice it specifically adds that he did cast away his garment. Now, this represents, not trusting in anything else. And it has nothing to do with sin. It has nothing to do with, getting rid of all your goods, to come to Christ. It has to do with not trusting anything else. Okay? He's taking anything else that he could have possibly trusted in this life. And of course, this is like a simile or a similitude of that. And he's saying, I don't need these things. I'm going to throw it all away. And then I'm going to come to Christ. Then it goes on to say, And Jesus answered and said unto him, What wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. Now, of course, this is a picture of salvation. When people are lost, they are spiritually blind. And in this story, he was physically blind. But see, when a person gets saved, it's like they can see now. Okay? And so this is a picture of salvation. It goes on to say, And Jesus said unto him, Go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way. So this is a picture of faith. See, a lot of people think that they can come to Christ and they can hold on to other things that they're trusting in. Like, for instance, they think that I'm not sure if Jesus is enough. They're scared that if they keep on sinning or whatever, that they may not go to heaven. And what these people are doing is they're saying, well, I'm going to trust in something else as well. I'm going to try my best. I'm going to try to live the good life, and I'm going to, turn from my sins, and I'm going to get baptized, and I'm going to, have faith until the end, and I'm going to trust in all that as well. And those things are great, but you can't trust in those things. You have to trust in Jesus Christ alone. That's why it's very important that we understand that before he came, he cast away his garment. He cast away all trust in anything else. Then, of course, he had faith in Christ. He got saved. And then, of course, in this case, he followed Jesus Christ. And that's the order that it should come in. You get saved by grace through faith alone in Christ alone. And then you should follow Christ. But the point is that you cannot have faith in two things. That's why this is a picture of faith. He cast away his garment, pushed away anything else that people want to trust in. And a lot of people have a hard time with this. They just don't get it. And they think they're going to be okay, and it's the opposite, okay? Jesus Christ died. He's the only one that can save. He's the only one that does save. And you have to put your faith completely in him alone, nothing else. These people are scared to do that. They think that's not going to work. But of course it's going to work, because That's what the Bible teaches. Now, let's take a look at some verses that make this clear, that you cannot add. And that's the point I believe we get from this story about the cloak of Bartimaeus, is that he threw away his garment, because the garment represented something else that you're finding security in. So let's take a look at some verses that make it very clear that you have to trust in Jesus alone, and you cannot trust in anything else. That's the point. John chapter 5 and verse 43, it says, "I come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. If another shall come in his own name, him ye will receive. How can ye believe, which receive honor one of another, and seek not the honor that cometh from God only?" What he's saying is that when you're trying to seek honor from other people, you're trying to get other people's approval in how you live, or, you know, and you're trying to get glory in something you do, it's saying right here that you can't believe. How can you believe? So that goes away and just basically just whitewashes this notion that you can believe in more things than Christ. I've heard people actually say, "Well, I've done more. I've believed in Jesus, and I'm trusting in my works, and I'm trusting in my baptism, and I'm trusting in, you know, turning from sins." That's not belief at all. That's unbelief, and that's just trusting in other things, and that's going to send you straight to hell is what that's going to do. Now, let's turn over to Hebrews. See, you can't trust in two things, because there's only one way to heaven. Jesus Christ said, "I am the way." He didn't say, "I'm one of the ways." Okay, he is the only way. He's the only one that died on the cross. He's the only one that qualified. That's why you trust in him alone, plus nothing. And this concept is hard for a lot of people to grasp. Anyone who believes correct on what I'm teaching is going to be called, you know, easy believism. And you know what? That's fine. Because, you know, I'd rather be easy believism than hard trust in yourselfism and going to hellism. So it doesn't really matter what these people say. The fact is, they're just afraid to trust in Jesus alone. It talks about this again in Hebrews chapter 4. It says in verse 8, "For if Jesus had given them rest, then would he have not afterward have spoken of another day. There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. For he that is entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works, as God did from his." So what is that telling us here? In order to get saved, you enter into the rest by faith. You have to give up on your own works. See, the false prophets say you have to give up sin. You have to give up, you know, the things you're doing. No, you just have to give up on trusting anything else. It has nothing to do with what a person's doing. It's what they're trusting in. That's the point here. Okay, now let's take a look at one more verse on this. In John chapter 6, we see a real great illustration about salvation. It reads in verse 35, it says, "And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. And he that believeth on me shall never thirst." Okay, he's telling you, just come to him by faith. Don't let anything hinder that. Don't trust in anything else. He's the source. He's the bread of life. He's the only way to get to heaven. And when you come to him by faith, when you believe on him, you'll never hunger and you'll never thirst. That means you're going to heaven, because when you go to hell, you're going to be hungry and thirsty. So he's talking about just simply believing on him, having faith in him, and there's nothing accompanied to it. Because like I've already said, you can't add to faith without erasing it. Okay, Isaiah chapter 45 says, "Look unto me, and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God, and there is none else." There's nobody else to look to. You look to Christ alone, put your faith alone in Christ alone. At that moment, you're saved forever. You're eternally secure. And yes, it is that simple. And that's what the Bible teaches. That's all I have. Dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says on this very important subject. Bless the listeners. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.